साथ इस स्टडी सर्कल सेशन में जुड़े हुए सभी साथियों को मैं वेलकम करती हूँ कलेक्टिव की तरफ से। आज हमारे साथ आज एक हम स्टडी सर्कल रख रहे हैं पेट्रियार्की इन द न्यू लिबरल एरा पे, पितृसत्ता और नवोदारवाद पे। ये आज स्टडी सर्कल का सेशन रखा गया है। हमारे साथ आज सेशन लेने आए हैं वनेसा चिश्ती, जो जिंदल ग्लोबल लॉ स्कूल में फैकल्टी हैं। वो इस विषय पे आज हमारे साथ चर्चा में एक शुरुआती तौर पे इंट्रोडक्टरी एक लेक्चर प्रेजेंट करेंगी। उसके बाद हम ऑडियंस में से लोगों के कमेंट्स और क्वेश्चंस लेना चाहेंगे। आप लोग क्वेश्चंस और कमेंट्स फेसबुक और जूम मीटिंग दोनों के ही माध्यम से हमें भेज सकते हैं। सेशन शुरू करने से पहले ये बोलना चाहूंगी कि हम फिर से इस महीने एक स्टडी सर्कल का सीरीज करें, जिसमें पहला सेशन हिंदू कॉलेज से अर्चना अग्रवाल ने लिया था इंट्रोडक्शन टू मार्क्सिस्ट इकोनॉमिक्स पे। इस नवंबर हम बोल्शेविक रेवोल्यूशन को मानते हुए चार विषय पे ये स्टडी सर्कल कर रहे हैं। पहला था, जैसे मैंने बोला, मार्क्सिस्ट इकोनॉमिक्स का एक इंट्रोडक्टरी सेशन। दूसरा था सोशलिज्म और कैपिटलिज्म का एक ब्रीफ हिस्ट्री इन द 20th सेंचुरी। तीसरा, आज जैसे मैंने बोला, न्यू लिबरलिज्म के एरा में पितृसत्ता का सवाल, पेट्रियार्की का सवाल। और चौथा सेशन हम रखेंगे डेवलपमेंट के क्या मायने हैं अलग अलग, और उससे जोड़ के प्रेजेंट कॉन्टेक्स्ट में भी क्या चेंजेस लाए जा रहे हैं इस पे, और लेबर रिजीम, लेबर कोड रिजीम और आसपास भी हमारे जो डेवलपमेंट्स हैं उनको साथ में जोड़ते हुए। तो आज इस सेशन में आने के लिए मैं वेलकम करूंगी कि वनेसा चिश्ती हमें एक इंट्रोडक्टरी लेक्चर दे इस सवाल पे। ओवर टू यू वनेसा। चीज सॉरी ऐड करना चाहूंगी कि जैसे जैसे लोग जोड़ भी रहे हैं उसके कुछ देर में हम एक गूगल फॉर्म सर्कुलेट करेंगे। ये हम रेगुलर एक अटेंडेंस रखने की कोशिश कर रहे हैं ताकि हम ऐसे विषयों पे और भी स्टडी सेशंस कर पाएं और उसमें आप लोग सभी हमारे साथ जुड़ पाए। तो वो थोड़ी देर में आपके चैट बॉक्स में आ जाएगा, आप उसमें अपना डिटेल्स, नंबर, ईमेल आईडी ये हमें भेज सकते हैं। थैंक यू एंड वी वेलकम वनेसा। वनेसा, यू कैन बिगिन।
गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन। जैसा कि शब्दों ने बताया, मेरा नाम वनेसा है। आई एम अ हिस्टोरियन, जिंदल लॉ स्कूल सोनीपत में पढ़ाती हूँ, और बहुत लंबे टाइम से सोशलिस्ट और फेमिनिस्ट पॉलिटिक्स से नाता भी रहा है, इंटरेस्ट भी रहा है, कुछ उस पर काम करने की भी कोशिश भी रही है। तो व्हेन आई वाज, मैं आज, मेरी हिंदी ठीक है, मतलब बहुत अच्छी नहीं है, बहुत खराब भी नहीं है, लेकिन मेरा कंफर्ट खासकर इस टाइप की चीजों पर बात करने का इंग्लिश में ज्यादा है। तो आई ट्राई माय वेरी बेस्ट कि जितना मुझसे मुमकिन हो पाए मिक्स करने की कोशिश करूंगी, और बाकी कोई चीज अगर मैंने इंग्लिश में बोली जो ना समझ आई तो साथी पूछ सकते हैं, चाहे मेरे बोलते हुए चाहे डिस्कशन के समय, उस पर दोबारा बात। So, kind of the title of the session, I have to say, is kind of a little misleading in terms of कि मेरा खासकर neoliberalism पे बात करने, neoliberalism पे भी मैं बात करूंगी, और neoliberalism के दौर में what are the forms that women's struggles can and must take, and what are the forms of politics that we must kind of work to develop. But as I was kind of thinking about what I will talk about and what I want to talk about, also because I don't have a very clear sense of the audience, I don't have a sense ki aap log matlab how much agreement is there already with, say, left politics, how much agreement is there already with feminist politics. तो मैंने ये सोचा कि मैं ज्यादा प्रिज्यूम ना करते हुए, मैं लाइक आई डोंट वांट टू प्रिज्यूम टू मच अग्रीमेंट विथ आइदर ऑफ दीज थिंग्स, एंड देन आई थॉट, यू नो, एज अ स्लाइटली ओल्डर पर्सन, इफ आई वाज स्पीकिंग टू स्लाइटली यंगर पीपल हु आर इंटरेस्टेड एंड इन्वॉल्व्ड इन पॉलिटिक्स, व्हाट आर सम ऑफ द थिंग्स दैट आई वुड लाइक टू टॉक अबाउट। तो मैं कैपिटलिज्म, विमेन्स ओप्रेशन, सोशलिज्म, विमेन्स लिबरेशन, I have a little bit to say about all of these things. Yeah? Also because what I'm presenting to you guys today, it also bears the mark of my own journey. Yeah? That as a young person, encountering pehle feminism se encounter hua to kuch cheezein samajh aayi duniya ke bare mein, power ke bare mein, samaj ke bare mein, aur uske baad kuch saal baad mera marxism se socialist politics se encounter hua. So the kind of the journey of being a feminist and then becoming a socialist feminist and then figuring out what it means to be a socialist feminist, and particularly feminism ka or socialism ka, ya agar, if I speak more generally, that what is the relationship between a women's liberationist politics, kyunki auraton ke liberation ke liye feminism is the most important and the best known tradition, but it's not the only tradition of thinking about women's liberation. Dusre tarike, dusre taraf, socialism, Marxism, these I think to my mind are the most compelling forms of anti-capitalist politics, but they are not the only forms of anti-capitalist politics. So kind of the organizing thread of my presentation today will be what is the relationship between women's liberation and anti-capitalism? Is there necessarily a relationship between women's liberation and anti-capitalism? And I'm going to give away the ending. The answer is going to be yes. And I intend to argue that to be someone who is a feminist or someone who is interested in the liberation of women, or the liberation of women can also be described more generally as the liberation of persons and bodies and sexualities from the oppressive binary of gender roles. So us sab ke liye ek anti-capitalist politics kyu zaruri hai, वो मैं आप लोगों से आज बात करने की कोशिश करूंगी. जस्ट टू गेट स्टार्टेड, सो आई एम काइंड ऑफ वर्किंग ऑन द असम्पशन कि आप जितने भी लोग यहाँ पे आए हुए हैं, हम जितने भी लोग यहाँ पे हैं, देयर विल बी डिफरेंसेस इन काइंड ऑफ समझदारी के डिफरेंसेस होंगे, नॉलेज मतलब किसको कितनी चीज पता है उसमें भी कुछ डिफरेंस होगा, बट आई थिंक इट्स सेफ टू प्रिज्यूम कि हम लोग जितने भी यहाँ पे हैं, we are all in some sense interested in radical human flourishing. Yeah, that hum like apne aap ko kisi bhi naam se bulaye, one thing that I'm certain all of us have in common is ki hum log apne aas paas ki duniya dekhte hain, hame lagta hai ki there are so many forms of dehumanization, so many forms of oppression, so many forms of violence. Koi to tarika hoga in sab cheezon ko samajh ke, analyze karke in sab cheezon ko khatam karne ka. Yeah, there has to be a way of creating a world in which human beings can flourish. Yeah, there has to be a way of, and then socialism is one expression of this, feminism is one expression of this, anti-caste politics is one expression of this, right? So, किसी भी type का progressive politics या किसी भी type का अगर आप radical politics की बात करें, उनके बीच के differences बहुत सारे हैं, उनके बीच के disagreements बहुत सारे हैं, points of contention बहुत सारे हैं. Lekin every form of radical politics is interested in human flourishing. It's interested in creating the social circumstances for human flourishing. Yeah. To us cheez ko main ek, I think it's safe to presume that as a common point of agreement. So abhi agar hum, if we are kind of working on the assumption gap to ho gaya na, I've assumed ki we are all interested in radical human flourishing, and I'm just going to kind of go with that. So if you're interested in radical human flourishing, if you're interested in emancipating human beings of one or the other category from one or the other kind form of oppression, then the first question that has to be confronted is what is the obstacle to flourishing? कि वो क्या चीज है जिसकी वजह से लोगों की लाइफ में डिग्निटी नहीं है, वो क्या चीज है जिसकी वजह से लोगों की लाइफ कमी नहीं है, वो क्या चीज है जिसकी वजह से लोगों की लाइफ is full of desperation or full of violence of various kinds. And the if we are talking particularly about the question of women, then the answer to that is one answer to that is patriarchy, yeah, male dominance. And patriarchy shabd ko leke kafi sara debate hai. Kuch log ka manna hai ki patriarchy is not a term that is appropriate to describe the systems of male dominance in capitalism, so on and so forth. उस पे मैं थोड़ी देर बाद कुछ बात करूंगी. तो सम फॉर्म ऑफ मेल डोमिनेंस क्लियरली एग्जिस्ट इन द वर्ल्ड टूडे एंड इट मेक्स इट्स अ ह्यूज काइंड ऑफ to the flourishing of human beings. Now, the question then becomes, what is the basis of, so when we talk about male dominance, what we mean is that there are something about the way in which collective life is organized that places women at a systematic disadvantage and places men at a systematic advantage, loosely speaking, because not all men are equally powerful, nor are all women equally powerless. But that's kind of the general idea, that there's a systematic advantage offered to men and systematic disadvantages that women suffer. And just to kind of make a couple of things about the, how do we understand the basis of women's oppression? How do we understand the basis of male domination? And I'm going to kind of not discuss this too much, but just I wanted to say one thing, which is that I think Friedrich Engels is an important figure who has written about the history of women's oppression. And one of the things that's truly remarkable about him is that he is one of the earliest people to draw attention to the fact that that women's oppression, that the roots of women's oppression lie in the collective organization of social life. Yeah, that women are not oppressed because people are mean. Women are not oppressed because men have some mysterious power psychology, nor are women oppressed because they have some mysterious psychology of submission and passiveness. But rather, the forms of oppression that women are subjected to, and there are numerous, and they need not be kind of listed here, that they are rooted in the collective organization of social life. औरतों के साथ जितने भी प्रकार का डिस्क्रिमिनेशन या ऑपरेशन होता है उसकी वजह कोई इट्स नॉट लाइक सम मिस्टीरियस साइकोलॉजिकल एक्सप्लेनेशन बट रादर देयर इज समथिंग अबाउट द वे इन विच सोसाइटी इज ऑर्गेनाइज्ड देयर इज समथिंग अबाउट द वे इन विच इंस्टीट्यूशंस एंड रिलेशंस इन सोसाइटी आर ऑर्गेनाइज्ड विच क्रिएट्स the basis for women's oppression. And when we ordinarily talk about women's questions, there is sometimes an emphasis, a proportionate emphasis on the issues of women as women. Yeah, so the question of sexual violence, sexual harassment, that's kind of in some senses a question of women as women. But as we talk about this today, I would also like to suggest that when we think about women's interests, yeah, there's an important distinction that this socialist feminist writer makes between women's interests and gender interests. Aur unka kehna ye hai ki women of course have gender interests and interest in like legal and safe abortions, for example, and interest in strong mechanisms for the redressal of sexual violence and sexual harassment. But the category of gender interest does not exhaust the categories of women's interests, because in addition to gender interests, women may also have class interests. Women may also have interests that have to do with some other aspect of their social identity and some other aspect of their social being. So in addition to kind of some of the things that I've mentioned, it's also very clear that women like in society suffer because of a few things. Yeah? One is, and we are all familiar with this in one way or the other, the sexual division of labor, where the idea of the woman as primarily a housewife and the idea of woman as somebody whose place and horizon is primarily the household. Yeah? Ki, औरत तेरे घर से बाहर, फिर भी औरत को एक हाउसवाइफ के रूप में देखा जाएगा, और औरत की जगह जो है उसको घर में ही देखी जाएगी कि औरत की जगह, औरत का संसार, औरत का क्या एस्पायर कर सकती है, वो सब उसको सब घर के अंदर समेट के रखने की कोशिश होती है. इन एडिशन टू दिस देयर इज द फैक्ट दैट लाइक देयर इज अ ट्रेमेंडस अमाउंट ऑफ लेबर मार्केट डिस्क्रिमिनेशन दैट वुमेन एनकाउंटर, नॉट ओनली इन द फॉर्म ऑफ लेबर मार्केट सेगमेंटेशन की कुछ खास किस्म की नौकरियां हैं जो औरतों को मिलती है जिनको पिंक कॉलर जॉब बोला जाता है, कि आप यू नो आप मैनेजर ना होंगे सेक्रेटरी होंगे, आप डेंटिस्ट ना होंगे डेंटल असिस्टेंट होंगे, सो दिस काइंड्स ऑफ रिलेटिवली लो स्किल लो पेइंग लो स्टेटस लो प्रेस्टीज जॉब्स दैट वुमेन टेंड टू बी कॉन्सेंट्रेटेड इन. फैक्ट दैट इन एडिशन टू labor market segmentation of this kind, rates of unemployment for women tend to be higher. Okay, so what we're talking about is on the one hand a tremendous tremendous burden of unpaid, unvalued, unrecognized household work which women perform in addition to wage work when wage work is available to women. And even when wage work is available to women, the conditions and terms of employment tend to be highly inequitable and so on and so forth. And it's not just a matter of domestic labor. It's not just a matter of, getting the worst jobs, getting the worst pay, and often also not getting jobs in situations where jobs are limited and so on. Women really kind of get the worst of it. And this manifests in numbers of ways. The statistics that scholars are able to generate for the number of hours in a week that women will spend working. So the amount of work that women in the world do is kind of disproportionately larger. And on the other hand, if you look at control over property, control over income, women are kind of, they do most of the work and they own very little of the wealth that kind of is produced as a consequence of that. So maybe ये शायद थोड़ा डिटेल हो गया, बट आई थिंक मेरा जरूर पॉइंट ये है कि हम लोग जब महिलाओं के इश्यूज की बात करते हैं, जहां पे पहले एक जमाने में इफ यू लुक एट डिबेट्स इन द 50s और 60s में जो लेफ्ट के अंदर बातचीत होती थी या और तरीके के प्रोग्रेसिव सर्कल्स में बातचीत होती थी, उसमें खाली एजुकेशन एम्प्लॉयमेंट इस टाइप के मटीरियल क्वेश्चंस पे बातचीत होती थी एंड देयर वाजंट इनफ अटेंशन पेड टू थिंग्स लाइक सेक्सुअलिटी सेक्सुअल वायलेंस यू नो एंड दीस काइंड्स ऑफ क्वेश्चंस ऑफ एम्बॉडीमेंट क्वेश्चंस ऑफ एक्सपीरियंस. और आज के समय में मुझे लगता है एंड मे बी दिस डजंट अप्लाई टू यू गाइस, मैं शायद अपने स्टूडेंट्स के बारे में ही सोच रही हूँ क्योंकि मेरी उन्हीं लोगों से ज्यादा बातचीत होती है, बट देयर इज अ वे इन विच जब हम लोग महिलाओं के इश्यूज की बात करते हैं हम कभी समटाइम्स वी लिमिट आवर सेल्व्स टू थिंकिंग ओनली अबाउट काइंड ऑफ क्लासिकली विमेन एज विमेन इश्यू. Whereas what I'm trying to say is that in addition to there being specific issues which are questions of women as women, forms of oppression that women encounter precisely because they are women, so wage discrimination or sexual assault being the classical examples, but I also want us to increasingly kind of cultivate a habit of thinking of women's issues as much larger, as kind of encompassing a much wider range of things. Yeah, so kind of women's interests, therefore, are the category of women's interest basically is a wider category than that of gender interest. And it's that's kind of so basically cultivate a practice of looking at gender also as a material question. Yeah, and looking at gender also as a question of those very boring things of किसके पास पैसा कितना है, huh? And kind of the reason that I'm opening with this is not at all to suggest that our questions are less important or अभी हम लोग कोई hierarchy of issues बनाएंगे कि सबसे बड़ा problem क्या है सबसे छोटा problem क्या है, but it does strike me that in a world where material dependence is not only it's not only treated as a cause for shame, but material dependence also is something that limits people's ability, women's ability to stand up for themselves, to resist various other forms of oppression, I do think that the question of material dependence and the question of material deprivation is absolutely fundamental question. Yeah, I think sexual autonomy, bodily autonomy is an important question. I think being able to cultivate spaces and practices where sex is something where, you know, where you can think through both the implications of power in sex and also find ways of seeking and enjoying pleasure that are kind of that are safe, consensual, healthy. Even something like that, the power to negotiate, the power to say yes or no, the power to leave or stay. I'm not saying it's exclusively a matter of economic independence or exclusively a matter of material questions, but that really is a kind of fundamental condition of autonomy and dignity. So having said that, my point, again, like I think I should also need to keep an eye on the time. When we talk about women, we have to think of women's interests as not just in terms of gender interests. We also have to think of women's interests in terms of class interests and so on and so forth. Now, the second kind of point that I wanted to make, because, and this is perhaps the point that I want to make because I'm a historian, which is that when we talk about women's oppression or when we talk about any form of oppression, I think historical specificity is something that is really, really important. Historical specificity se mera kehne ka matlab ye ki hum log jab baat, we know that capitalism se pehle jo samaj tha, a capitalist mode of production se pehle jo samaj tha, usme bhi auton ka oppression hota tha. Usse pehle bhi auton ka oppression hota tha. Aaj ke time mein bhi auton ka oppression hota hai. Right? But I think it's really important to pay attention to the ways in which these different, in different forms of societies, in different historical periods, alag alag samay mein, auton ka oppression किस तरीके से हो रहा है उसकी एक अलग हिस्टोरिकल स्पेसिफिसिटी होगी. Right? So what is the peculiar system of male dominance that is characteristic of, say, pre-capitalist societies? What is the peculiar system of male dominance that is characteristic of capitalist societies? This is a question that I think is extremely important. And the question of what the form of
I think Vanessa has just accidentally exited the Google Meet. I'll just contact her and get her back to the so sorry for this, but I request everyone to just wait for a minute.
Hi guys, sorry, I got kicked out of the meeting. I have an unstable internet connection. So basically, as I was saying, that it's important to be attentive to historical specificity, and it's important to be attentive to the fact that even though women have been oppressed in different forms of society in different times, we shouldn't make too much of that similarity, because there are often very important and very profound differences between the particular relations of oppression and the particular forms in which the dominance of men or the subordination of women is ensured in particular societies. So in capitalism, there is capitalism kind of transforms pre-capitalist class and gender relations in really fundamental ways. And perhaps I can go into this in a little bit more detail in the discussion if anybody has a specific question about it. But the general point that I want to make is that, you know, some of these things that we take for absolutely for granted in the modern world, which have a peculiar relevance to women and women's questions, such as this idea of the division between the public and the private, that there is a domain of home and there's a domain of work, that there is a domain that is public, there is a domain that is private. This distinction, which is obviously a gender distinction, the public is synonymous with the male and the private is synonymous with the female. So this division between a private and a public sphere, and also this idea of domesticity, this ideology of domesticity, this ideology of domesticity का मतलब सिर्फ ये कि जो लोग ये मानते हैं, ये मानना कि औरत की जगह घर में है, और घर को संवारने का, घर को संभालने का, घर को मेंटेन करने का, अगेंस्ट ऑल ऑड्स वो रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी औरत का है. Now this it's very easy to look at this idea and think ki haan ye to kuch traditional sekdo saal purana patriarchal idea hoga, ye to matlab kuch bahut hi purana idea hoga jo ki kuch feudal times se aata hai. But it's interesting that this ideology of domesticity, ki ek to ye ki ghar aur kaam ki jagah alag ho gayi hai, public aur private spheres alag ho gaye hain, this is itself something that's a sociological transformation that's produced by capitalism. And then the creation of these ideas of that, the idea that there is a natural unity between woman, family, home, reproduction, care work, and sexuality, this is something that takes place in the 19th century. Yeah, and it takes place closer towards the end of the 19th century than earlier on in the 19th century. So as I was saying, that this I don't really have a specific point that I'm making with this immediately. But what I'm trying to say is that even though women are oppressed in pre-capitalist societies as well as in capitalist societies, the specific form, the basis, the institutions and relations that ensure and uphold that oppression are quite distinct in different forms of society, and certainly quite distinct in a capitalist society. This is the point of time in a presentation like this when somebody, when a presenter might want to reflect specifically on what are the ways in which capitalism, a kind of women's oppression, is or is not necessary for capitalism. Yeah, can capitalism exist and accumulate and generate profit without oppressing women, or does capitalism necessarily require the oppression of women? Now this is a question that is an exceedingly difficult one, and a question that, although I've been interested in for a very long time and had a very firm position on till very recently, it's a question that I have a very kind of complex, ill-formed opinion on right now. I wanted to mention this because I'm saying this is possibly one of the things that could be discussed, but I don't want to make like a simple, definitive statement on it right now. But the important thing is that even if we set aside the question of functional dependence, does capitalism necessarily oppress women as women? And therefore, is it possible to emancipate women within the framework of capitalism, or is it necessary to transcend or kind of do away with capitalism to emancipate women? I wanted to talk a little bit about that question. Okay. Now, I think irrespective of where we fall on the question of functional dependence, key capitalism does oppress women as women, or capitalism oppresses women, but only insofar as they are workers, even without taking a firm position and even kind of with different positions that can be taken on that, how do I react to the mushrooming of private universities? Well, maybe that's a topic for another session, but I'm also happy to address that question in the discussion. So even without getting into this, specific conversation about functional dependence, I do think that it is possible to say some very elementary, and I think really quite difficult to, some things that are elementary and really quite difficult to argue with. Okay. And let me just focus now on laying out what some of those things are. And then maybe another 15, 20 minutes and I'll stop. What is capitalism? Okay. I'm going to offer you guys a very, very simple answer to this question. And this is, there's a text called Socialism, Utopian and Scientific, written by Friedrich Engels. And this is a phrase from that. Engels describes capitalism as collective production and private appropriation. Collective production and private appropriation. Which means simply that production under capitalism in factories or in any other kind of capitalist enterprise, production is performed through collective labor, that it is the labor of all kinds of workers within a particular enterprise, manual workers, quote unquote, mental workers. That produces the wealth that produces whatever commodity, which then is later converted into money on the market. But although the production is collective, the appropriation is private, which means ki kaam sab log saath mein karte hain, aur logon ke saath mein kaam karne se hi वेल्थ प्रोड्यूस होता है, वैल्यू प्रोड्यूस होता है, लेकिन जो प्रोड्यूस होता है उस पे काम करने वाले लोगों का हक नहीं है. या वो अब उसको जब अप्रोप्रिएट करने की बारी आती है कि जो भी प्रोड्यूस हुआ है उसको डिवाइड कैसे किया जाए, किसको कितना मिलेगा, किसको क्या मिलेगा, जो काम करने वाले लोग हैं उसमें उनको सबसे कम मिलता है, दे गेट द स्मॉलेस्ट शेयर ऑफ व्हाट इज प्रोड्यूस्ड, एंड द those who are owners of capital, those who kind of are able to claim the largest portion of what is produced as a return on investment, as profit. So that is basically kind of what capitalism is. What is the objection to this? Yeah, the objection to this that Marxists offer, and the objection to this that anti-capitalists in general offer, is that two things. One, capitalism is characterized for various reasons that are kind of intrinsic to the logic of capitalism. Capitalism is characterized by a drive towards limitless accumulation. Yeah, there is no internal limit within the logic of capitalism. There is no limit to how much can be accumulated, or how much the kind of intent to accumulate. There's no inner restraint on accumulation. The more important problem, yeah, for our specific purposes is ki jo bhi surplus produce hua, jo bhi collective mehnat se khane ki cheez, pehenne ki cheez, kuch aur cheez jo produce hui hai, that us pe bahut ek chote section ka control hai ki jo ek saathi mehnat se, saath mein log kaam karne se jo bhi material cheezein produce karte hain, बजाय इसके कि वो सबके भले के लिए इस्तेमाल हो, बजाय इसके कि वो लोगों के कंट्रोल में हो, All the wealth that is produced is controlled by a small capitalist elite who will spend that money naturally not on improving people's lives or welfare, but they will spend that money on either personal consumption or reinvesting it into profit to maintain that cycle of limitless accumulation and that cycle of limitless profit. So, ye cheez hai, and of course, you guys have done more other sessions on this. You've already talked about the political economy of capitalism. You know much more in detail about capitalism. But I'm saying this is a fundamental kind of truth about capitalism. Log saath mein produce karte hain, aur jab usko uspe milkiyat ki bari aati hai, to it's a wo chand log hain. जो सिर्फ प्रॉपर्टी राइट के बेसिस पे बिना अपनी कुछ मेहनत कंट्रीब्यूट किए हुए वो सारी चीज पे सारे सरप्लस पे क्लेम करेंगे. तो सोशलिज्म, व्हाट इज सोशलिज्म देन? या सोशलिज्म इज बेसिकली और सोशलिज्म और एंटी कैपिटलिज्म इज बेसिकली द कंटेंशन और द बिलीफ दैट व्हाट इज कलेक्टिवली प्रोड्यूस्ड शुड ऑल्सो बी डिस्पोज्ड ऑफ कलेक्टिव. कि जो भी चीजें जो भी मटेरियल चीजें जो प्रोड्यूस करते हैं लोग अपनी मेहनत से, उस पे लोगों का हक होना चाहिए. या सो द डेमोक्रेटिक कंट्रोल ओवर इकोनॉमिक सरप्लस दैट इज बेसिकली सोशलिज्म और एंटी कैपिटलिज्म इन वन. ओके, अब आप में से कई लोग जानते हैं कि इतना सिंपल भी नहीं है कि सोशलिज्म है, सोशल डेमोक्रेसी है, कम्युनिज्म है, ये है. एंड देयर इज ऑल काइंड्स ऑफ डिफरेंट ट्रेडिशंस, ऑल काइंड्स ऑफ डिफरेंट डिबेट्स विद इन द लेफ्ट कि यू नो स्टेट को कैसे देखा जाए, इसको लेके कुछ अलग अलग वो है. इंडिया में मोड ऑफ प्रोडक्शन को कैसे देखा जाए, पॉलिटिकल स्ट्रेटजी को देखा जाए. इसमें सिर्फ यहाँ पे इंडिया में नहीं, दुनिया भर में बहुत सारे डिबेट्स हैं. बट आई एम सेइंग दैट द बेसिक प्रिंसिपल, द बेसिक आइडिया ऑफ सोशलिज्म इज दैट वेल्थ दैट इज कलेक्टिवली प्रोड्यूस्ड मस्ट बी कलेक्टिवली डिस्पोज्ड ऑफ. कि अगर सब लोग मिलके मेहनत करके कुछ चीज क्रिएट कर रहे हैं, दैट वेल्थ कैन नॉट बी फॉर द प्राइवेट एनरिचमेंट ऑफ अ स्मॉल ग्रुप ऑफ पीपल अलोन. नाउ दिस आई वॉन्टेड टू मेंशन ऑल्सो बिकॉज I promise there's a specific point about women and women's oppression coming here, but just one more thing I'll say. There was no greater admirer of capitalism than Karl Marx. And that may sound like a weird sort of a thing to say, because although Marx was and remains the most militant and the most cogent critic of capitalism, there is something that he admired about capitalism, which was the capacity of capitalism to produce abundance of the kind the world has never imagined. Yeah. And the problem, of course, is that capitalism produces abundance, but then allows it to be appropriated privately by a very small group of people. But I think the point about abundance is an important one, because, you know, and I can't say this with confidence because I haven't actually gone around the world and counted all the wealth that exists in the world. But if you look at estimates, I can say with some confidence that, you know, enough wealth already exists in the world. There is already enough food, enough clothes, enough houses. There is already enough material wealth in the world to meet the basic material needs of everybody several times over. There is already enough wealth in the world to ensure that everyone has at least the basics of what a safe, dignified life might mean. The trouble, of course, and this is the problem with capitalism, is that most of this wealth is controlled by people like Jeff Bezos. Yeah? And most of this wealth, which is produced by ordinary people, which is produced by factory workers, assembly line workers, that is controlled by Jeff Bezos. So what I want to say, basically, then this is going to be like the last point that I make, is ki, the question of What does this have to do with women? Yeah, कि दुनिया में already बहुत सारा abundance है, दुनिया में already मैं जो पहले कह रही थी कि दुनिया में already इतना धन है, already इतनी चीजें हैं दुनिया में कि हर किसी की जरूरत पूरी हो सके और हर किसी की जरूरत like material needs and other things can be met several times over, as I was saying. Now, what does this have to do with women? Yeah. What this has to do with women is that if social surplus, if the wealth that is produced by society collectively is subject to some kind of democratic control, and what the form of that is there are kind of almost endless debates about that. वो कैसे होगा? स्टेट के पास रहेगा या सोवियट्स के पास रहेगा या वर्कर्स कंट्रोल होगा या कुछ और होगा, उन स्पेसिफिक चीजों में मैं अभी नहीं जा रही हूँ. बट इफ ऑल द वेल्थ दैट इज प्रोड्यूस्ड बाय सोसाइटी वो अगर लोगों के हाथ में हो तो मेनी काइंड्स ऑफ थिंग्स बिकम पॉसिबल, मेनी काइंड्स ऑफ रियल कॉन्क्रीट ट्रांसफॉर्मेशंस बिकम पॉसिबल. राइट, सो जब एंगल्स महिलाओं के सवाल पे लिखते हैं या और लोग जो एक सोशलिस्ट ट्रेडिशन के अंदर महिलाओं के सवाल पे लिखते हैं, द इंडस्ट्रियलाइजेशन ऑफ हाउसवर्क, द कलेक्टिवाइजेशन ऑफ हाउसवर्क इज समथिंग दैट ऑल ऑफ देम एम्फसाइज. या एंड बिकॉज उनके कहने का मकसद यह है कि जब तक औरतों को घर के काम से आप छुटकारा नहीं दिलाएंगे, that it is difficult to imagine even things like psychological autonomy, sexual autonomy and freedom and so on, right? So the industrialization of housework, imagine, you know, and let's take a look at what happens in families today. Yeah, ki matlab bachcho ko palne ka kaam, bachcho ki koi bhi zarurat puri karne ka kaam wo auraton ka hota hai, chahe maa ka ho, chahe some other female member of the family, and you know, so the care of children is such a difficult and challenging task and such a socially necessary task, you know, and it's left to be performed by overworked, marginalized, disgruntled and very unhappy women in individual households. Right? And if social surplus is something that if that the wealth of society is something that is subjected to democratic control, I think, you know, it becomes possible to actually conceive of the collectivization of housework, the social industrialization of housework, as a concrete step towards emancipating women from the sexual division of labor and emancipating women from being confined to domesticity. So I don't know if the point is being made clearly, but what I'm trying to say is ki, but, and again, this is not saying anything very specific about women in general. Yeah, this is just saying that socialism or some form of anti-capitalist politics, which is directed at establishing popular democratic control over the wealth that exists in a particular society, it is a necessary but not a sufficient condition for the end of other kinds of oppression. Yeah, खाली economic independence दे देने से, खाली housework को socialize कर देने से कि मान लीजिए कि घर में खाना ना बनाना पड़े, collective mess हो, घर की सफाई ना करनी पड़े, कुछ और उसका arrangement हो, बच्चे सिर्फ माँ की responsibility ना होकर एक कलेक्टिव रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी के रूप में बच्चों को पालने, पाल को उसके बड़ा करने की, उनकी उनकी जो जरूरतें हैं उनको पूरा करने की एक कलेक्टिव एफर्ट हो, ऑल ऑफ दैट इज काइंड ऑफ रियली फंडामेंटली ओनली पॉसिबल व्हेन देयर इज पॉपुलर कंट्रोल over surplus, over the wealth that is produced in society. So what I'm saying is ki even if you don't want to, even if you don't get into a specific kind of theoretical debate about functional dependence or otherwise, Even if you don't want to kind of get into a very specific formulation, I think the basic idea is an elementary one and it shouldn't be a difficult one to accept. Ki agar aap auton ko bhala karna chahte hain, या अगर आप अगर आप चाहते हैं कि एक ऐसा समाज हो जिसमें किसी भी प्रकार का यू नो रेशियल डिस्क्रिमिनेशन ना हो, कास्ट डिस्क्रिमिनेशन ना हो, काइंड ऑफ क्रिएटिंग अ कॉन्टेक्स्ट दैट इज नॉट परवेसिवली मार्क्ड बाय मटेरियल डिपेंडेंस, वो तो एक बहुत ही एलिमेंट्री और बहुत ही बेसिक चीज है कि चाहे आप किसी भी टाइप किसी भी टाइप के ओप्रेशन से लड़ने के लिए, किसी भी टाइप के ओप्रेशन को खत्म करने के लिए, चाहे वो जेंडर हो, रेस हो, कास्ट हो, सेक्सुअलिटी हो, एबिलिटी हो, एबिलिज्म हो, किसी भी प्रकार का चीज ये अगर हो, इट्स emancipation of people that belong to any and all of these categories, it's simply not possible if rich people control all the wealth. Yeah. And so what I'm saying basically is that doesn't matter what kind of radical politics you are interested in, it doesn't matter what category of people कि आप किस किन लोगों के एमांसिपेशन में आप सबसे ज्यादा एक इन्वेस्टमेंट और सबसे ज्यादा एक कमिटमेंट फील करते हैं. द डेमोक्रेटिक कंट्रोल ओवर वेल्थ एंड डेमोक्रेटिक पॉपुलर कंट्रोल ओवर मटेरियल रिसोर्सेज, वो तो एक तो बिल्कुल बेसिक सी चीज है कि जब तक आप उसको एंश्योर नहीं करेंगे या उसके लिए काम नहीं करेंगे, इट्स इम्पॉसिबल टू कंसीव ऑफ true emancipation in any deep and profound sense. Actually, I think this is all I'll say for now, because I was also trying to keep an eye on the questions as they were coming up. So, I guess questions now?
Thank you, Vanessa. I can hear myself. Thank you, Vanessa, for that presentation. मतलब chat box में दो questions already और एक तीसरा भी आ गया है. एक मेरा खुद का भी सवाल था इससे जोड़ के actually पहले question से. So I think we can start with the questions in the chat box.
Now I have to figure out how to see
that. Yeah, so I had noted down the two questions that came pehle. One was ki women were not always oppressed in pre-capitalist societies. Isme matlab tribal societies ka bhi example diya gaya hai kafi jagah. And so how does one address that? Second was to do with the wages for housework movement. So, sexualized division of labor or public-private division or domestication leke to domesticity leke ek portion tha presentation ka. Usme agar ye is tarike ke demands ko lekar jo movement raha, uspe bhi if you can shed some light. Ki matlab wages, the question goes ki does it subject women to the realm of the home or does it emancipate them?
Correct. That's
next. I think इसमें पहले जा सकते हैं. Then there's a question on relationships in the present neoliberal era, जिसमें मतलब family कैसे change हो रहा है, ये सब लेके भी है. जिसमें मतलब I also had a few questions about neoliberalism in particular, उसका क्या role रहा, मतलब both education, employment के realm में भी women का क्या मतलब status ऊपर कुछ सेंस में गया, इन द सेंस ऑफ मतलब एजुकेशन और बट किस सेक्टर में एम्प्लॉयमेंट मिल रहा है, और एक्चुअली हाउ देन मतलब द पार्ट ऑफ द प्रेजेंटेशन व्हिच आई थिंक यू टच्ड अपॉन एंड देन डिडंट गो इनटू फर्दर, व्हिच इज कि कैपिटलिज्म के अंडर स्पेसिफिकली कैसे मतलब ये डोमेस्टिसिटी का आइडियोलॉजी, पब्लिक प्राइवेट डिविजन, ये अगर ब्रेक भी हो रहा है थ्रू सम कंसेशंस व्हिच हैव ग्रेजुअली बीन गिवन थ्रू अ वुमेन्स मूवमेंट here as well, but उसमें फिर क्या क्या बच भी रहा है और neoliberalism फिर कैसे reshape कर रहा है पूरी चीज, तो ये एक aspect है. But I think first two questions, then we can take initially and then neoliberal wala next.
Okay, so these are all great questions also, because my presentation was kind of quite a general one and it's good to get questions that are so specific. Pehla sawal ye ki women are not always oppressed in pre-capitalist societies. Now, ye bahut aham sawal hai. और इस पे एक्चुअली मैं दो चीजें कहूंगी. एक तो ये कि एक तो वन थिंग दैट यू दैट वी ऑल हैव टू कीप इन माइंड इज दैट जब हम प्री कैपिटलिस्ट सोसाइटीज की बात करते हैं, देर आर टू काइंड्स ऑफ प्री कैपिटलिस्ट सोसाइटीज. देर आर कैपिटलिज्म से पहले जो और तरीके की क्लास सोसाइटीज थी, अब क्लास लाइक सोसाइटीज एंड नॉन क्लास सोसाइटीज दैट एग्जिस्टेड बिफोर कैपिटलिज्म. तो क्लास सोसाइटी से अपना मतलब सिर्फ ये है कि कोई ऐसा समाज जो कम से कम दो वर्गों में बटा हुआ है और एक वर्ग काम करता है और दूसरा वर्ग मेहनत लूट के खुद लेबर किए बिना दूसरों की मेहनत के फल को लेकर उसको एंजॉय कर पाता है. तो इन एंगल्स का ये एक आर्ग्यूमेंट है कि जहां पे भी क्लास सोसाइटी है, कि जहां पे भी समाज का वर्गों में बंटवारा हो गया है और कुछ लोग काम करके जीते हैं और कुछ लोग औरों की मेहनत लूट के जीते हैं, वहां पे पेट्रियाकल रिलेशंस, मेल डोमिनेंस के रिलेशंस भी होंगे. So, I think the specific thing is not ki pre-capitalist societies mein male dominance tha ki nahi, female women's oppression tha ki nahi. I think the specific question is ki class societies mein women's oppression tha ki nahi, aur jo societies class societies nahi thi, unmein wo women's oppression tha ki nahi. To ispe Engels ne jab se likha hai, uspe bahut sara हिस्टोरिकल एंथ्रोपोलॉजिकल काम हुआ है, हिस्टोरिकल काम हुआ है, और मुझे उसके बारे में बहुत ज्यादा नहीं मालूम है. लेकिन लेकिन एक चीज ये है कि इसमें कोई डाउट नहीं है कि देर इज अ क्लोज कनेक्शन बिटवीन द क्रिएशन ऑफ क्लास सोसाइटीज एंड द क्रिएशन ऑफ ओप्रेसिव जेंडर रिलेशंस. क्योंकि ये भी तो बात है ना कि जहां पे यू कैन हैव सोसाइटीज जहां पे एक सेक्सुअल डिविजन ऑफ लेबर है कि औरतों का ये काम है, आदमियों का ये काम है, औरतें बच्चों को देखती हैं, आदमी ये वाला काम, दूसरा कुछ काम करते हैं, बट अ सेक्सुअल डिविजन ऑफ लेबर, इट नीड नॉट बी एन हायरार्किकल डिविजन ऑफ लेबर. यू कैन ऑल्सो हैव इंस्टेंसेज जहां पे एक सेक्सुअल डिविजन ऑफ लेबर है और औरत के काम को इज्जत मिलती है, महत्व मिलता है, उसको जरूरी माना जाता है, और आदमी के काम को भी जरूरत मिलती है, इज्जत मिलती है, और वो है. तो द क्रिएशन ऑफ ओप्रेसिव जेंडर रिलेशंस एंड द क्रिएशन ऑफ नॉट जस्ट अ सेक्सुअल बट ऑल्सो अ हायरार्किकल डिविजन ऑफ लेबर, that is something that correlates historically with the creation of class societies. I think. Okay, so is that an adequate response to that question? Ya kuch aur wahan pe tha jo main nahi respond kar paayi.
I think we can have next. Correct.
Wages for housework wala jo sawal hai, this is a really important question and it's a question. Okay, so on this ye jo debate hai na functional dependence wala ki kya capitalism औरतों को oppress karta hai ya capitalism aur कैपिटलिज्म औरतों को ओप्रेस करता है और उसके लिए जरूरी है, या कैपिटलिज्म औरतों को ओप्रेस करता है लेकिन उसके लिए जरूरी नहीं है, उसके बिना भी अक्यूमुलेशन हो सकता है, उसके बिना भी कैपिटलिज्म रिप्रोड्यूस कर सकता है. तो ये वेजेस फॉर हाउसवर्क वाला जो कैंपेन है सेविया फेडरिची और लोगों का, ये एक ऐसा है इस डिबेट के अंदर जिनका मानना है कि कैपिटलिज्म इज फंक्शनली डिपेंडेंट ऑन द ओप्रेशन ऑफ वुमेन. तो उनका कहना यह है कि जो कैपिटलिस्ट रिलेशन है जो कि हम लोग एक वर्कप्लेस में देखते हैं कि एम्प्लॉयर है और एम्प्लॉई है और एम्प्लॉयर जो है एम्प्लॉई को एक्सप्लॉइट कर रहा है, उनका ये कहना है कि वो कैपिटलिस्ट रिलेशन वो देखने में नहीं लगता बट असल में वो घर के अंदर भी एक्सटेंड करता है. तो उनका कहना यह है कि जो आदमी मान लीजिए फैक्ट्री में जाके काम कर रहा है, उसका एक्सप्लॉयटेशन फैक्ट्री में हो रहा है, उसकी जो घर में औरत जो वाइफ बैठी है, चाहे वो फैक्ट्री में नहीं भी जा रही है लेकिन क्योंकि वो घर में काम कर रही है और घर में बहुत तरीके का ऐसा काम कर रही है जिसकी विच एनेबल्स द मैन टू गेट अप एंड गो बैक टू वर्क इन द फैक्ट्री. तो उनका ये मानना है कि डोमेस्टिक रिलेशन जो है वो भी कैपिटलिस्ट रिलेशन ऑफ प्रोडक्शन का ही हिस्सा है और उसी का पार्ट है. इससे मेरा डिसएग्रीमेंट है, बट लाइक मे बी दैट समथिंग दैट कैन फोकस ऑन दैट राइट नाउ. ये जो स्पेसिफिक सवाल है दैट वेजेस फॉर हाउस वर्क डज इट इमेंसिपेट वुमेन और कन्फाइन वुमेन टू द हाउस होल्ड, दिस एक्चुअली सिल्विया फेडेरिची हरसेल्फ एड्रेसेस इन द वेजेस अगेंस्ट हाउस वर्क मैनिफेस्टो. And wages against housework, not wages for housework, because what Federici is arguing in the opening passages of that is ki we are not saying ki hum ghar ka kaam karenge, aap hame paise dijiye aur agar hame paisa milega to hum ghar ka hi kaam karte rahenge. हम लोग घर के काम के लिए पैसा इसलिए मांग रहे हैं सिर्फ ये बताने के लिए कि जताने के लिए कि ये भी काम है और ये भी एक ऐसा काम है जो महत्वपूर्ण है, ये भी एक ऐसा काम है जिसके बिना समाज का रिप्रोड्यूस होना इम्पॉसिबल है और जिसके बिना कैपिटलिज्म का रिप्रोड्यूस होना भी नामुमकिन है. सो द आइडिया ऑफ वेजेस फॉर हाउस वर्क इज नॉट लिटरली टू डिमांड वेजेस फॉर हाउस वर्क, बट बाय डिमांडिंग वेजेस फॉर हाउस वर्क टू मेक विजिबल द फैक्ट दैट व्हाट वी पास ऑफ एज लव इन द हाउस होल्ड, कि माँ करती है प्यार के लिए, पत्नी करती है प्यार के लिए, कि वो सब काम है, वो प्रेम नहीं, वो काम है. तो इस चीज पे अटेंशन ड्रॉ करने के लिए दे आस्क फॉर वेजेस फॉर हाउस वर्क, बट द इंटेंशन इज नॉट कि अगर पैसा मिलेगा घर का काम करने का तो अपन घर का ही काम करते रहेंगे. द इम्प्लीकेशन इज कि हम लोग घर के काम के लिए पैसा मांगेंगे तो लोगों की आंखें खुलेंगी, लोग कंफ्यूज होंगे कि ये लोग कर क्या रहे हैं, और फिर लोगों को समझ आएगा कि ये भी श्रम है, ये भी काम है जो घर के अंदर होता है. And I think the purpose ultimately is to destroy the wage relation, destroy the domestic relation, and imagine some form of society outside of it. Neoliberalism को लेके जो सवाल था वो चाहे chat box में है ना, can I just read that and then respond?
हाँ, the question is actually on कि family relations कैसे change हो रहे हैं under neoliberalism, and मतलब is it more liberating than relations in any previous epochs? And but I think इसमें और भी चीजें जोड़ के we can then have a मतलब because the neoliberal aspect
Let me say one thing about neoliberalism then, and maybe then you guys can kind of tell me more specific questions to respond to. देखिए ये जो पहले हम लोग बात किया ना कि कैपिटलिज्म कलेक्टिव प्रोडक्शन प्राइवेट अप्रोप्रिएशन का, आप सब लोग साथ में करेंगे, सब लोगों के श्रम से मिलके ही जो भी चीज है तैयार होगी, लेकिन उसको जब एंजॉय करने की बारी आएगी, जब ये फैसले की बारी आएगी कि अच्छा ये तो बन गया जूता या ये तो बन गया जो भी कप बन गया, अब इसका करना क्या है, वो फैसला मालिक का होगा, मजदूर का नहीं होगा, जिसने श्रम किया उसका फैसला नहीं होगा. तो अब कैपिटलिज्म के अंदर भी मतलब देर आर डिफरेंट रेजिम्स ऑफ अक्यूमुलेशन, कि कैपिटलिज्म तो एक जनरल लेवल है बट कैपिटलिज्म के भी अलग अलग स्वरूप होते हैं इतिहास में. राइट, तो न्यूलिबरलिज्म जिसको हम बोलते हैं, कुछ पिछले 30-35 साल से ये शब्द भी बहुत चर्चा में है, और न्यूलिबरल जो पॉलिसीज हैं वो भी अलग अलग रूप में दुनिया भर में इम्प्लीमेंट हुई हैं. एंड वन ऑफ द न्यूलिबरलिज्म का जो बेसिक पॉइंट है वो ये कि जो सरकार है वो कारोबार को जो भी प्रोडक्शन वगैरह है इकोनॉमी से सरकार हाथ पीछे हटा ले. कहने का मतलब ये कि टैक्सेस कम हो, रेगुलेशन कम हो, बिजनेस को और ज्यादा फ्रीडम हो, लेबर लॉज जो हैं कि आप किसी को अगर काम पे रख रहे हैं तो उनके कुछ राइट्स हैं, लेबर लॉज पे एक असॉल्ट है क्योंकि यू नो लेबर लॉज आर एन इनकन्वीनियंस फॉर द कैपिटलिस्ट्स आफ्टर ऑल बिकॉज दे अटेम्प्ट टू रेगुलेट द पिच ऑफ एक्सप्लॉयटेशन. तो उसी के साथ साथ एक पर्टिकुलर चीज ये है कि जो सरकार का जो वेलफेयर स्पेंडिंग होता है, सरकार जो हेल्थ केयर पे है, जो पढ़ाई पे है, या अलग अलग टाइप के प्रोग्राम्स पे जो स्पेंडिंग करती है सरकार पब्लिक वेलफेयर के लिए, वन ऑफ द बिगेस्ट एस्पेक्ट्स ऑफ न्यू लिबरलिज्म इज की दैट वेलफेयर स्पेंडिंग इज ड्रास्टिकली रिड्यूस्ड, विच मीन्स की शिक्षा पे खर्चा कम होगा, वो हम अपनी आंखों के सामने होते देख ही रहे हैं, हेल्थ केयर पे खर्चा होगा कम होगा, पेंडेमिक हो रहा है, एंड जस्ट लुक एट द स्टेट ऑफ मेडिकल इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर इन दिस कंट्री, क्या पब्लिक क्या प्राइवेट. और जब सरकार इन चीजों पर खर्चा कम करती है, वॉट इज दैट मीन? दैट मीन्स की जो जो काम किसी की सेहत को, लाइक टेंडिंग टू समवन्स हेल्थ, टेकिंग केयर ऑफ अ सिक पर्सन, टेकिंग केयर ऑफ एन ओल्ड पर्सन, ऑल ऑफ दैट वर्क विल देन फॉल्स बैक ऑन टू वुमेन. एंड ये जनरल सी बात नहीं कर रही हूँ मैं, दिस इज समथिंग जो स्टेटिस्टिकली बहुत वेल डॉक्यूमेंटेड है लैटिन अमेरिका में, अफ्रीका में, साउथ एशिया में, साउथ ईस्ट एशिया में, नॉर्थ अमेरिका में, साउथ अमेरिका में, मतलब दिस इज समथिंग दैट इज बीन रिसर्च्ड एंड इज वेल एस्टैब्लिश्ड, दैट अ डिक्रीज इन वेलफेयर स्पेंडिंग बाय गवर्नमेंट्स मींस एन इंक्रीज्ड बर्डन ऑफ केयर वर्क एंड एन इंक्रीज्ड बर्डन ऑफ अदर काइंड्स ऑफ वर्क. So that I think is one of those specific implications that neoliberalism has for women, in addition to women also being affected by, you know, in rising inequality, by other kinds of things as well. So in what way does neoliberalism change the family? ye kehna actually is very, very exceedingly difficult. Yeah. And if I'm not mistaken, that is the it's very difficult, because to be able to answer the question of how capitalism is changing family structures, how neoliberalism is changing family structures, one would have to pick up a specific example and look at a particular place ki wahan pe family structure hai kaisa aur jo bhi. But I think one thing is possible to say ki more and more of the work of reproducing the family and more of the work of reproducing the household, jitna public spending kam hoga, jitna welfare spending kam hoga, utna zyada a household is thrown onto its own resources. Yeah. And that has implications for women, because jab bhi adversity hota hai, jab bhi kuch मतलब पैसे की तंगी होती है या मेहनत ज्यादा होती है या किसी और टाइप की कोई दिक्कत होती है, किसी और टाइप की कोई सख्ती होती है, दैट फॉल्स डिस्प्रोपोर्शनेटली ऑन. Yeah, and ye cheez kind of a trend towards rising sexual violence has been observed in the context of neoliberalism, although I'm not aware of any literature that's drawing a direct causal link between the two, but that's a significant correlation that we cannot take. And I think there was also a question on
the USSR, there was a question on liberate. One aspect was ki our relations then more liberating today than but I think that aspect was covered in what you said also slight. Next question mein I'll just then say, matlab ye, there's one question on the status of women in the USSR. Particularly, like before, the question says, before the capitalist vices crept in. Mm-hmm. And I mean, primarily that women are getting educated, but why not coming to, I think, higher political power. But I think it's a jodte hue, if we can also speak about what actually did happen on these questions in that time period in the USSR. Especially like you were talking about collectivization of housework, of reproductive labor. So if we can deal with both, because it's a historically relevant and specific example as well of the future we are talking about. So,
you know, I have to be honest, guys, कि ये इस चीज में कि USSR में कोई general sense है, हाँ, कि post revolutionary USSR या post revolutionary China के बारे में एक मोटा मोटा sense है मुझे, मेरा इस पे खास कोई पढ़ाई या कोई ऐसा specialized वो नहीं है. But I can say I want to say a couple of things. One specific, one general. One specific thing that immediately comes to mind is ki post-revolutionary China mein jab aurton ko property rights mile, ki jo women in the countryside were given rights in land, like ownership rights in land for the first time, you had a surge in divorce rates. कि मतलब इट्स लाइक कि औरतों को जमीन मिली एंड देयर लाइक अच्छा ठीक है अभी हो गया था ऐसा डिवोर्स चाहिए अपन जा रहे हैं तो एंड दिस आई रेड दिस रेड अबाउट दिस इयर्स अगो एंड दिस इज ऑलवेज स्टूड आउट इन माय माइंड एज एन एग्जांपल ऑफ समथिंग या व्हिच इज दैट व्हेन यू डेमोक्रेटाइज relations or when you democratize economic relations in society, that will inevitably have a knock-off effect on other kinds of things. Yeah. So, and I think there's actually a great book about this, which is called Why Women Have Better Sex Under Socialism. And it's definitely a book that everyone should check out. So my point is basically that, you know, in these post-revolutionary societies, because it was possible, because the state was a state that actually represented the people or at least in some sense represented and addressed the welfare of the people, it became possible to introduce these huge structural changes, the legalization of homosexuality in the USSR, for example. Yeah, the removal of laws that would place children born out of wedlock at a disadvantage. Yeah, these kinds of changes in policy and laws, but also other kinds of macro changes, changes in property relations, changes like efforts at collectivizing housework, and so on and so forth. And I think the general lesson that emerges from these experiences is that when it becomes when material relations become more egalitarian, people are empowered to fight in defense of autonomy, fight in defense of their dignity. Yeah,
रिलेशनशिप ऑफ 21st सेंचुरी neoliberalism with the neo-right worldwide. And what are the implications of that on sexual violence, autonomy, and anti-women ideology?
There are also some other questions, but I suppose you will kind of read them out as you go.
There was one kind of discussion in the middle, and then there's a specific question asking for readings on the history of feminism in India. There was one comment and like question on the relation of marriage to private property, whether it's arranged or love marriage. I think in continuity with this thing about changing structures in the family under neoliberalism, whether it's arranged marriage, love marriage, yeah.
There's actually a point that Mary John ka article hai. Mary John, you guys might know, she's an economist and actually economist, sociologist, she's many things. But unka kaam hai, where the point that she's making is that precisely the point that Jeannie's comment is making, yeah, that although the subjective meaning of marriage can be many things, ki किसी का पर्सनल रीजन हो सकता है ना कि प्यार का कि मतलब सच में प्रेम करते हैं बहुत अच्छा रिलेशनशिप है एगालिटेरियन रिलेशनशिप है ये वो बट इन इट्स स्ट्रक्चरल एस्पेक्ट मैरी का कहना है कि वी मस्ट रिगार्ड मैरिज एज एन एनफोर्स्ड रिलेशनशिप ऑफ डिपेंडेंसी बिकॉज हियर आर द नंबर्स सो जब ये सक्षम रिपोर्ट पे काम कर रहे थे दे वर लुकिंग एट सेक्सुअल हरासमेंट इन हायर एजुकेशन दे डिड एन एक्सटेंसिव सर्वे एंड दे फाउंड दैट ऑलमोस्ट हाफ ऑफ द स्टूडेंट पॉपुलेशन इन हायर एजुकेशन कैंपसेस इज विमेन पिछले पिछले 20 साल में जो औरतें जो कॉलेज पढ़ रही हैं, बीए एमए इस टाइप की हायर एजुकेशन में आ रही हैं, उनकी संख्या बहुत बढ़ गई है. सो मच सो कि नाउ वुमेन आर ऑलमोस्ट 50% ऑफ हायर एजुकेशन कैंपसेस. या एंड वन काइंड ऑफ सिग्निफिकेंट थिंग दैट मैरी टॉक्ड अबाउट इज हाउ इट्स नॉट जस्ट वुमेन बट इन एवरी कैटेगरी द नंबर्स ऑफ द proportion of Dalit women on campuses has increased. The proportion of, even though these still remain very small percentages, but even the relative proportion of Muslim women on campuses has increased. But on the other hand, if you look at the labor force participation rate of for women in India, it's one of the lowest in the world. Yeah, and the labor force participation is 15%. And if I'm not mistaken, what that means is that of all women of employable age who are seeking employment, there are large numbers who will not find employment. So half of your higher education campuses are full of women who are getting BA, MA, MPhil degrees, who knows what else. But then there are no jobs for them. And the highest number of jobs for women are domestic help and primary school teachers, apparently. And the largest growing sector of employment for women is domestic help. You know? So where are all these other women going to go? And another thing that she points out in this essay, which I should definitely share with you guys, is ki the labor force participation in India, the higher the level of education, the lower the participation in the labor force. Yeah. So if you, what is happening here, this is telling you two things. One, it's telling you that a lot of those women that are going to college and getting degrees and perhaps having aspirations and dreams, that they're not going to find jobs. And then they will be forced into marriage. You know, like one hopes that there will be love marriages, and one hopes that there will also be some subjective element of desire and consent in those marriages. But there's no, as you said, there's no escaping the fact that for most women, marriage is not a choice. Marriage is a structurally enforced form of dependence.
Yeah. And I mean, at a later date, you could share the article also, like after the session, maybe we can circulate it among people. As far as readings are concerned, there was a request for suggestions for readings on the history of feminism in India, specifically from the 12th century onward.
From the 12th century onwards, I'm being a historian now, but women's movement proper 19th century se pehle duniya bhar mein kahin nahi tha. So 12th century, I'm a little confused. 12th century, dekho, women expressing expressing desires for freedom, women औरतों का aspiration होना कि काश मुझे ये ना करना पड़े, काश मुझे ये करने की अनुमति हो, काश मैं वो कर पाऊँ. Those kinds of individual expressions of yearning and perhaps individual acts of resistance की समाज के बिल्कुल विपरीत जाते हुए कोई एक औरत कोई चीज कर पा रही है, या समाज को बिल्कुल वो करते हुए कोई एक औरत कोई ऐसी चीज कर रही है जो अलाउड नहीं है. बट विमेन्स मूवमेंट जिसको कहेंगे ना, कि मतलब एकत्रित होके संगठित होके एक ऑर्गेनाइज्ड फाइट फॉर एडवांसिंग द कलेक्टिव इंटरेस्ट ऑफ विमेन, दैट इज अ यूनिकली मॉडर्न फिनोमेना. जस्ट एज मास पॉलिटिक्स इटसेल्फ इज अ यूनिकली मॉडर्न फिनोमेना. तो विमेन्स मूवमेंट 19th सेंचुरी से पहले जहां तक मुझे मालूम है नहीं हुआ है, बट समथिंग ऑन द हिस्ट्री ऑफ फेमिनिज्म इन इंडिया आई कुड डिग अप.
Yeah, then I think the one thing that remains is relation between emergence of the neo-right, 21st century neoliberalism, and I think it's relevant also, like in the past few years itself we have seen, मतलब ब्राजील हो, यूएस हो, एक तरीके का रेजिम का आना, और उसके साथ मतलब विमेन्स मोबिलाइजेशन इज ऑल्सो हैपनिंग, वेर आफ्टर सम गैप एक्चुअली मतलब इन दिस लार्ज वे ऐसे सेक्सुअल वायलेंस और ऑटोनॉमी का सवाल भी उठ के आ रहा है, और अटैक भी एक्चुअली बढ़ा है. तो इसका मतलब relation pe, if you can.
I'm actually so glad that this question has been asked, because it's actually something that I had written down that I wanted to speak about but then skipped over. इसपे किसी ने रीडिंग रेकमेंडेशन मांगा नहीं है, बट मैं फिर भी रीडिंग रेकमेंडेशन देने वाली हूँ. स्टुअर्ट कॉटब्रिज और जॉन हैरिस का एक किताब है. I'll get the book and I'll tell you guys what exactly the. Yeah, I don't have it here. On kind of the history of Hindutva, हाँ कि हिंदुत्वा का history, politics India के अंदर, और बहुत ही बढ़िया किताब है, बहुत ही बढ़िया किताब है. And one of the उनका एक formulation है जो मुझे लगता है कि सिर्फ इंडिया के context में नहीं, एक global level पे ये concept relevant है, which is that they वो कह रहे हैं कि हिंदुत्वा is an elite revolt. It's a backlash of the upper caste, upper class elite against various kinds of social movements which have been able to force various kinds of concessions or various kinds of demands on governments. Yeah. So think about Hathras and think about usme kis tarike ka ek bilkul matlab besharmi se matlab literally besharam. I'm not using besharam as an adjective here. I'm saying it's literally bina kisi sharam ke. What we saw is an open kind of completely unapologetic defense of upper caste masculinity, of caste power, and so on and so forth. Right? So unka kehne ka maksad ye hai ki चाहे इंडिया की बात कीजिए या चाहे आप दुनिया भर की बात कीजिए, देर आर सोशल मूवमेंट्स, वुमेन्स मूवमेंट्स, वर्कर्स मूवमेंट्स, एंटी कास्ट मूवमेंट्स, एंटी रेसिस्ट मूवमेंट्स, यू नो, दैट हैव बीन फाइटिंग इवन द व्हाट आर कॉल्ड द न्यू सोशल मूवमेंट्स, जिनके एक लंबे संघर्ष की वजह से इन वेरियस पार्ट्स ऑफ द वर्ल्ड यू हैड स्लाइटली बेटर लॉ, लाइक यू नो, डिसेंट laws, abortion is legal, for example, gay marriage is legal, and this kind of thing. You have an SCST, Atrocities Act in India, yeah, for what it's worth. Where the alt-right is drawing its force is from two places. One is the core leading element of the alt-right is the core leading element of the alt-right across the world is this elite, which is now engaged in a full-fledged backlash against all of these claims of liberation and all of these claims that people had successfully forced. Yeah. So in India, for example, the core of the alt, like the core of this far right, is upper caste, kind of very masculine language, very masculine politics, and so on and so forth. In the United States, the core of this alt-right is a white supremacy. That's the thing. So the character of the revolt is the character of the far right in that sense. I think it's safe to say it's a backlash against progressive gains that have been made by various movements. तो इसमें कोई हैरानी की बात है ही नहीं कि आप कहीं भी दुनिया में उठा के जो ये ऑल्ट राइट है, जो ये पॉपुलिस्ट राइट है, जो भी इसको बोलना है, कहीं भी दुनिया भर का एग्जांपल उठा के देख लीजिए, दे आर कमिटेडली सेक्सिस्ट, कमिटेडली सेक्सिस्ट. लुक एट बोल्सोनारो इन ब्राजील, या लुक एट द look at what is this Hindutva in India, yeah, like this, and some people in the comments are talking about love jihad. Absolutely. So my general point is that the right wing also draws much of its force precisely from this kind of a backlash. औरतें हाथ से निकल गई हैं, ज्यादा बोल रही हैं आजकल. ये दलित लोग आजकल हाथ से निकल गए हैं, देखो घोड़े पे बैठते हैं, स्पाइक बाइक खरीदते हैं, घी खाते हैं. सो दिस काइंड ऑफ इट्स अ रिएक्शन अगेंस्ट any conception of egalitarianism, yeah, any conception of politics that argues for a democratization of social relations, that argues for the correction of asymmetries in power relations, the far right is a form of extreme reaction against all of this.
Yeah. Mallika has a question now. Since I think जो हमारा टॉपिक था आज के लिए उसमें तो लाइक अ वास्ट रेंज ऑफ इश्यूज वी हैव कवर्ड एक्चुअली, तो मालिका हैज टू क्वेश्चंस शी वांटेड टू आस्क. मालिका यू कैन गो अहेड.
Hi, thank you. One of the questions that I wanted to ask was about RSS pinkwashing agenda. So now that since we're talking about Hindu nationalism, Hindu Rashtra and all that, so there's been this like new form of neoliberalism that's come up that reinforces patriarchy in such a gaslighty manner that you can't really differentiate. Like, so what I'm basically seeing is Abhijit Mitra and his proposition for same-sex marriage and how like that's a very problematic thing. So could you talk about that a little more, how the neoliberal economic thing has become so socialized and institutionalized that now it's just become a kind of a reality for most people? So that was the first question. And the second question was about biological essentialism. So I was reading Simone de Beauvoir's The Second Sex, and so she talks a lot about Frederick Engels usme and origin of family and all of that, ki private property is the cause of women's oppression and all that. But so usme biological essentialism pe jo wo baat karti hai ki it's usually the act of the function of penetration and the ovum becoming a passive act in reproduction and wo sab jo baat karti hai. So that comes into play into the reinforcement of neoliberal patriarchy, in the sense that since neoliberalism says free market on all that, so usme aap thoda baat kar sakte hain. So am I being clear? I don't know.
You ran through a lot of things very quickly. I think I've caught maybe two things that I can specifically talk about. एक तो pinkwashing का देख जो आपने बोला है उसके अलावा बोलने की कोई जरूरत नहीं है, because this is the form of politics in neoliberal society, in neoliberal this thing is that diversity is the buzzword. Huh? और इस पे तो इतने बढ़िया बढ़िया meme है, मैं क्या बोलूँ. A meme is like this one person who is very solemnly speaking on a mic or likha hua hai, there are 8 billionaires in this world who control more wealth than 50% of the population, and we believe that at least one of them should be black and at least one of them should be a woman. Yeah. So ye to sarasar bakwas hai. You put a woman on the board of a corporation, you put a gay person in the board of the corporation, aap same-sex marriage legalize kar dijiye. ये सब चीजें कीजिए आप, बट सो लॉन्ग इज द फंडामेंटल स्ट्रक्चर्स ऑफ डोमिनेशन एंड पावर इन सोसाइटी रिमेन अनचेंज्ड, आई डोंट थिंक इट मेक्स अ शिट ऑफ अ डिफरेंस टू एनी ऑफ अस कि वो पावर स्ट्रक्चर को कौन ऑपरेट कर रहा है. या तो आप मुझे ये प्रूव करके बताइए कि अगर कोई गे प्रेसिडेंट होगा यूनाइटेड स्टेट्स का, वो तो कम गिराएगा उसके गे होने की वजह से, या तो आप मुझे ये कन्विंस कर लीजिए. अदरवाइज आई रियली डोंट थिंक इट मेक्स अ दीज थिंग्स हैव सिंबॉलिक सिग्निफिकेंस. या अ गे प्रेसिडेंट, अ ब्लैक प्रेसिडेंट, अ व्हाइट प्राइम मिनिस्टर, इफ इंडिया हैज अ मुस्लिम प्राइम मिनिस्टर समडे, that would have a tremendous symbolic significance. Yeah. But in terms of actual relations of power, these are ways of dressing up the window so that nobody looks inside the window to see ki andar kya kachra hai. And I think there's really nothing else that needs to be said about pinkwashing. Yeah. The second point that you're making about I'm not really sure I got the question there, but I think what you're saying is ki Simone de Beauvoir, she seems to be speaking in an essentialist language when she's talking about, say, penetration or the passive principle of the ovum and the active principle of the sperm. Now, all due respect to Simone de Beauvoir, this is there's no sense in any of this. Biological essentialism is like it's such an irrelevant thing. I can't even begin to discuss it because this ideology of biological determination, the idea that because of differences in brain structure or anatomy or differences in hormones and genes, like I've done my research about this, I've not found even a single shred of evidence. It's well known that there is not a single shred of evidence that biology plays any kind of a determining role in shaping socially, in shaping social traits or shaping who we are. Yeah. Which is not to say that biology is unimportant. Of course, biology is important. It's important, for example, that we are, you know, people and not trees, and that we have lungs that allow us to breathe over in air, and we can't breathe underwater. So biology imposes some hard limits. इंसान का सोसाइटी पानी में नहीं हो सकता, वो खाली जमीन पे हो सकता है, बिकॉज वी नीड टू ब्रीथ ऑक्सीजन. राइट, सो बायोलॉजी इज ऑफकोर्स इम्पॉर्टेंट इन दोज वेज, बट बियॉन्ड दैट बायोलॉजी प्लेस एब्सोल्युटली नो रोल इन स्पेसिफाइंग एनीथिंग अबाउट सोसाइटी, बिकॉज यू नो लाइक आई एम सेइंग, बायोलॉजी डिक्टेट्स दैट ह्यूमन सोसाइटीज कैन ओनली बी फॉर्म्ड ऑन लैंड. But beyond that, what the form of that society will be, किस टाइप का होगा, कैसे वो लोग प्रोड्यूस करेंगे, क्या कैसे शेयर करेंगे, डिस्ट्रीब्यूट करेंगे, biology plays no role in specifying that whatsoever. And there's actually a wonderful essay by this person called Richard Lewontin, who's a Marxist biologist that I teach on my course on biological determinism. And it's just like such an excellent takedown of the ideology. He goes deep into the science and says kuch nahi hai, sab bakwas hai. And you don't even need to read the essay. The only thing that you need to understand is that all forms of society are biologically possible, and therefore society doesn't tell you anything specific about any society. Class society is biologically possible. Pre-class, non-class societies are biological societies with extremely horrifying and disgusting forms of hierarchy are biologically possible. Societies which are remarkably egalitarian, which have remarkably non-hierarchical social and collective lives, are also biologically possible. So if, you know, all forms of society are biologically possible, biology tells you nothing specific about society. That's kind of my general thought on biological essentialism, biological determinism. And I do think that the Lewontin essay, you guys should take a look at. It's a wonderful essay.
Great. Thanks, Vanessa, for coming in today. I think Abhi, questions though have, and whatever I also had has been addressed. So I think for today, we can wrap up here then, the discussion. We want to thank everyone who joined us today on behalf of Collective. And we want to especially thank Vanessa for her presentation and the ensuing discussion. And we'll keep in touch. There are different aspects of this discussion. Matlab, aitihasik taur pe kaise patriarchy develop kiya? Questions which I also have, which I think matlab aane wale samay mein ye discussion jari rakhte hain alag alag zariyon se. To abhi hum and people are saying already ki ek part 2 ki zarurat hai, jo mujhe bhi lagta hai. To
look, if you guys are interested in like an origin of women's oppression kind of thing, see, because in today's session, I kept it very general because I didn't know what to focus on. If we have some like a pointed origin of women's oppression, actually, I have some lovely readings on that. And that's also something that would be easy for me to prepare and do if you guys are interested.
Yeah, that would be really helpful. So abhi hum, then we can wrap this up. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you for having me, guys. This was fun.
Sure. Bye.
Bye-bye. Bye.